I am. We thank you that there is no other God beside thee. We thank you that you alone are the Lord. You are sovereign in your rule and in your reign. You have given to us the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. And we worship him in this house of worship this morning. We lift our hands in the presence of God, remembering your word, where Paul said, I would that men and women everywhere would lift up holy hands without wrath and without doubting to glorify and give honor to the King of Kings. Jesus, we thank you that because you're here today, all things are possible. We thank you that there is not anything that is impossible with you. This morning we put our trust in you afresh and in you, and we thank you for your presence today. Hallelujah. We thank you that in your presence there is joy beyond measure. We thank you that in your presence, Father, that we are encouraged and elevated. And Father, that we are edified in your presence. And we sense the presence of the Lord in this place today. And we give glory and we give honor and we give power unto the one who sits on the throne and unto the Lamb. Hallelujah. We magnify you, Jesus, this morning and give you all praise. Lord, we still our hearts in your presence. We bow our hearts in your presence. Hallelujah. Worship you. Thank you, Jesus. Father, I just want to speak life this morning over your people. I want to speak resurrection power over each and every life in this room today. We want to thank you, Jesus, that you are life and that you came to give life and to give it more abundantly. We praise you that the enemy is defeated. Father, I feel inclined this morning to pronounce victory over every person, over every family, Father, over every need. Small or great. Thank you that your grace is sufficient. Hallelujah. There's such a presence of the Lord here, even I feel like I can sing this morning. Hallelujah. The Lord dropped this word in my spirit as we were driving down I-65 towards you this morning, early. It's the word presence. Everyone say presence. If I get a little Pentecostal on y'all, you'll be okay with that, won't you? Because I feel a little lightness in my feet. I feel a little spark in my spirit because I'm in the presence of Jesus. Hallelujah. Well, if you're going to clap, give him a clap. Give him a mighty clap. Don't give him your football clap. Give him the clap. Don't give him a touchdown shout. Give him a shout. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My God is able. He will make a way. When you're in his presence, there are times you're in his presence, you don't even know you're in his presence. But you are. We are. And I thank him that we are. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I feel like loads are going to be lightened this morning. I feel like burdens are going to be unraveled. I feel like what seems impossible is going to yield way to the possibility of the Lord's work, because we're in the presence of God. Hallelujah. Now, I don't know about you, but there have been some times in my life when I've been desperate. But when I came into the presence of God, that desperation seemed to fade away. In the light of His goodness, in the light of His glory, in the light of His grace. Hallelujah. Is anyone here can say with me, Pastor, I know what you're talking about today. I've been in that place when I didn't know what I was going to do. But when I came into the presence of Jesus, suddenly something began to happen that I wasn't even expecting to happen. In just a moment, I'm going to bring you to a story in the Bible in Luke chapter 7. Where a woman had a need met in her life that she wasn't even expecting to be met that day. She was on her way to the cemetery. But when Jesus intersected her, something began to happen that she never expected to happen. I want you to touch somebody right now and say, go ahead to the cemetery if you must, but I'm going to stand here and I'm going to wait on my miracle. Hallelujah. Just go ahead and tell them that. Go ahead to the cemetery if you have to. But I'm going to stand here in the presence of Jesus. And I'm going to wait on my miracle. Hallelujah. Praise His mighty name forever. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. It's a joy to be here with you in this atmosphere. We are conducting a pastoral vote today, aren't we? But my goodness. Look, we've come right into the middle of a great and powerful worship service. Can you say yes? The presence of God is here, and this is the presence that I like to conduct the King's business in. Praise God. Karen and I are delighted to be here with you. Thank you for this warm greeting. More than that, more than anything, thank you for entering in to the presence of the Lord, and I appreciate the great worship set that Derek and the team has brought to us this morning. It's just confirmed in my heart what I need to be sharing with you. Mike really wanted to do something entirely different in this sermon this morning. But again, as we were driving down and we were worshiping the Lord with a great CD in our vehicle and just in the presence of God, the Lord began to nudge me about this passage and about this message in Luke chapter 7, and just momentarily I'll bring you to verse 11. We just want to say how thankful to God we are for you, for this house. We're thankful to God for this strong ministry and everything that you are doing to help build the kingdom of God. Thank you for your faithfulness. This is a faithful house, among other things. And I appreciate your faithfulness to Alpha Ministries, to the LPHC, and to the kingdom of God. You're just a great example of what faithfulness is all about. And I just want to say openly, thank you for this today. Praise God. And it's just a delight to see you all, and had an opportunity before the service to catch up with several of you. It's great to have Pastor Fred and Carolyn Stallworth in the house with us today. Amen. It's great that you've been in such great hands over these last few months with Pastor John and Beatrice Whitaker. Would you just give them a hand today? It's good that you're in great hands with this young minister of music, Derek Lewis. Derek's one of our young up-and-coming ministers. Great job, Derek. I think John Oglesby's in the house somewhere. Woo-hoo, John. People are glad to see you today. Come for a visit more often. It's good to see you. Where are you, John? I'm looking for you in the midst of all these lights. There you are. Good to see you today. And welcome home for a few days. Praise God. And it's just great. I wish I could call you all by name and just say a little something about you, but time wouldn't permit that. But we're deeply thankful to God for these leaders that I mentioned and many others who are helping you through this transition. And the Lord, is giving us a good plan and a good path. And we're just thankful for His presence here today. I want to bring you to this passage in Luke chapter 7, verse number 11. Brother Fred, I first kind of started thinking about this a couple of years ago. Karen and I were at a Council of Bishops meeting a couple of years ago. And Bishop Doug that morning, our presiding bishop, Dr. Doug Beecham, was just going to do a devotional thought with us. It was on this passage. A couple of the things I'm going to share with you are actually from his heart to us that day. And I need to give the presiding bishop credit. Can you say amen? And for a long time, for a couple of years almost, I just simply prayed this passage. A lot of times in my personal devotion, the Lord would bring this passage up in my heart. He'd bring the story up in my heart. I'd be thinking about difficult situations, and the Lord would bring this story up in my heart about a woman whose only son had died. And I would just reflect on the scripture, and I remember one or two things that Bishop Doug shared with us that morning that I will share with you momentarily. And with the Lord's help, I've kind of crafted and put two or three other things in of my own thinking and thought process. And I just want you to know today that there is nothing that God cannot do. Can you say amen? Amen. There is absolutely nothing that's impossible with God. And there's nothing impossible, therefore, in our life, in our ministry, in our church, when God is with us. I love what Pastor John was saying earlier, that God is with us. And that was another little confirmation to me, John, that I was hearing the Holy Spirit about this particular passage of Scripture this morning. Let me read the story for us. Chapter 7 of the Gospel according to St. Luke, verse number 11. Hallelujah. We praise you for your presence, Lord. The scripture says this to us, and I'm reading from the New King James Version. Now it happened the day after that he, speaking of Jesus, went into a city called Nain, and many of his disciples went with him, and a large crowd. Verse number 12, and when Jesus came near the gate of the city, behold, a dead man was being carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow. And a large crowd from the city was with her. When the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her. And it seems to me that as we've been going through this service, the Lord has been nudging me on several occasions, and I sense His compassion in this room this morning. Hallelujah. See, the compassion of Jesus wasn't just something that He ministered with 2,000 years ago, and then it was over. No, the compassion of Jesus, my friends, has stayed every day since that day until this day. And the compassion of Jesus will stay on every day until He comes. Can you say amen? Amen. And I believe that even in heaven, we will be reminded on an ongoing basis of the mercy and the compassion of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. If you believe that, say amen. When the Lord saw her, every time I read this, and every time I've ministered, this is only like the third or fourth time I've preached this, but every time I'm messed up, just like I am right now. So you pray for me that I can even get through this. because His presence is in this room. Hallelujah. And I'm just speaking right now over things that look like death, that there's going to be a turnaround in those situations in the name of Jesus. I'm speaking to disease. You're going to yield and you're going to give up to the healer, Jesus Christ. I'm speaking to broken relationships. You're going to be healed in the name of Jesus Christ. And everyone said, amen. I'm looking to everything that may seem impossible today with faith in my Savior and in my risen Lord. And I'm declaring you're going to live for the glory of God. Can you say amen? Clap your hands and give God praise. Come on and clap your hands and give Him praise. I feel like there's a spirit of revival that could break out in this room this morning. Hallelujah. Praise God. When the Lord saw her for a third time, I'll try it. He had compassion on her and He said to her, "Do not weep." How do you tell a widow woman whose only son who has died, who's on her way to bury this son, "Do not weep any longer"? I feel like saying over someone, I don't know who, but the 30th Psalm says, "Your weeping has endured for a night," but you know it, don't you? Say it with me. Weeping has endured for a, but joy cometh in the morning. I feel like I've come to tell somebody, you're in your morning. Hallelujah. Your nighttime passage has gone and it has ended and it is no more. So go ahead and just begin to praise God right where you are sitting, that your joy is coming up in the morning. Hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. I don't even know if I can get through this. I just feel like a shout's up in my bones here this morning. Glory, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Someone ought to just go ahead and praise Him for the thing you're coming out of. Go ahead and praise Him for the resurrection that's coming your way. Go ahead and praise Him for the financial breakthrough. Go ahead and praise Him for the life that's coming to you. Go ahead and praise Him that your weeping has endured for a night, but joy cometh up in the morning. Hallelujah. 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 I say to you, do not weep. Then Jesus came and touched the open coffin, and those who carried the dead man stood still. And Jesus said, "Young man, I say to you, arise." So he who was dead sat up and began to speak. And Jesus presented him to his mother. Then fear came upon all, and they glorified God, saying, "A great prophet has risen up among us, and God has visited His people." Come on now, can you say amen? Amen. God has visited His people. Does anyone feel the presence of the Lord with me this morning? Just wave your hand in His presence. God is visiting His people right here in Cantoma, Florida, on September 27th, 2015. Can you say amen? God is visiting His people in many other congregations across Escambia County, Florida, and Alabama, and across this nation. Can you say amen? God is visiting His people. Glory to God. And this report about Him went throughout all Judea and all the surrounding region. Here's my big idea for us this morning. And with your help, it will not take me long to get through this, because I want to bring you in just a few moments to the altar. My big idea is this: when God is in your life, nothing, absolutely nothing, is impossible. Our God is able. He will make a way. The Bible says He will even make a way where there does not seem to be a way. Hallelujah. Has anyone here ever experienced that kind of visitation from God? Hallelujah. You were in a place and you didn't know what you were going to do, but God came on the scene and began to make a way for you and for me and for us where there did not seem to be a way. Hallelujah. I remind you that He will never leave us. Can you say amen? Behold, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age. Hallelujah. The end of your life, or whatever the situation may be, God will never leave us. And I can also say to you with great confidence that our God will never fail us. Can you say amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Five things that I want to share with you this morning about this story as we think about impossible situations being turned around by the presence and by the glory of God. Number one, I've already referenced it slightly, but let me just get into it with you for just a little bit deeper. Number one, Jesus was moved with compassion by this grieving mother. The Webster's Collegiate Dictionary defines compassion like this: sorrow for the sufferings or the trouble of others, accompanied by a deep urgency to help. Somebody say amen. See, when Jesus had compassion on this mother that day in the city of Nain, and as Jesus is here in this room with us this morning, and I sense and feel His compassionate presence in this house today, it's not just that Jesus felt sorry for the mother, Sister Robbie, but Jesus felt everything that she was going through at that particular moment in her life, but He had the ability to take it beyond what He was feeling. He had the ability to help out in the situation, an urgency to help, and what is more, glory to God, He had the ability and the presence and the power and the authority to help her in that time. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. So when the compassion of Jesus is present with His people, it's not just that His mercy is being extended in and of itself, by itself. No, it goes beyond that, because He adds to His mercy presence, and He adds to His presence power, and He adds to His power capacity. Hallelujah. And He adds to all of that His undeniable truth, praise God. And He adds to that His undeniable authority. Hallelujah. I'm getting too happy for this. I've just lost my earpiece. It's behind me. Only the devil should be behind me. So I rebuke this mouthpiece and I command it to act right. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. I try not to be so excited here. I just know where I'm going with this. Praise God. And when you add all of that together, then you understand the biblical definition of compassion. Praise God. So in that moment when Jesus, who had a large crowd traveling with Him, and they had been in great crusades with Him, and they had observed Him healing the sick, all manner of sickness, disease. They had observed the crippled walk. They had observed blind eyes open. They had observed deaf ears coming unstopped and hearing again. They had observed the dumb mouth opening and speaking. They had observed Jesus casting out demons. Hallelujah. But just when you think you've watched Jesus do it all, hallelujah, just hold on, baby, because there's always more. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. I just feel like declaring over this house today, yes, you've had some great years, but I believe that there's something on the horizon here for you that is going to be beyond anything you've ever dreamed, thought, imagined. Hallelujah. Because the presence of the Lord is here. And you can feel Him in the atmosphere. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So Jesus felt
great sorrow for her sufferings. He felt her troubled heart and spirit. He felt her grief and her emotion. Oh, but it went beyond that, because Jesus said, "Father, what do you want me to do about this?" Because we know Jesus never did anything except what the Father was doing. Can you say amen? But thank God, in that occasion, it was the Father's good pleasure for Jesus to do something about that particular situation. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. There's two or three things about compassion I want you to get. Number one, compassion from Jesus always reveals his love for people. His love is constant. His is a love that never fails. His love always goes the extra mile. And his love knows no barriers whatsoever. Can you say thank God? Aren't you glad that whatever barrier was trying to keep you away from the love of God, Jesus didn't allow that barrier to keep himself from coming to you, and the Holy Spirit came to you anyway. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. Now, I don't know about you, but I didn't come necessarily from the right side of the tracks. I came from Turkey Creek, Alabama. Can any good thing come out of Turkey Creek, Alabama? You understand what I'm saying? Just say Turkey Creek. I mean, is there even a place on the face of the earth that's known as Turkey Creek, Alabama? Yes, there is. And that's where my grandparents lived on one side. And then the other set of grandparents lived in a place called Tarrant City, Alabama. But I've come with good news to you today. The love of God knows no boundary. The love of God knows no barrier. The love of God is able to reach down to you no matter where you are, no matter what you're going through, no matter what you're experiencing, no matter what life has dealt you, no matter what grief is in your heart, no matter what has you bound up weeping, praise God. Jesus has sent me to tell you today, weep no more. Hallelujah. Praise God. Yes. Hallelujah. I mean, you feel his presence in this place. I wish every one of you could just be up here preaching this message with me today. Hallelujah. Thank God that the compassion of Jesus reveals his love, but more than that, the compassion from Jesus demonstrates his infinite sympathy for the suffering of humanity. Hallelujah. Like a magnet drawn to metal, Jesus connected with the hurting, with the broken, with the sick, and with the oppressed. Acts 10 and 38 says to us about the life and the ministry of Jesus, that God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. And he went about doing good, healing all that were sick of the and oppressed of the devil. For God was with him. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. God was with Jesus. He said to us, "I will send you the Holy Spirit when I return to my Father, and the way the Father has been with me, so my Spirit shall be with you." How many of you know and believe today that the Holy Spirit is here in this room with us? Come on now, can you say amen? How many of you know and believe that we have an anointing from the Holy One ourselves? Can you say amen? And because we have this anointing from the Holy One, we have the same authority and the same power that Jesus demonstrated in his life, and we too can go about and do good with healing in our wings for the glory of God. If you believe it, say amen. See, the compassion of Jesus not only revealed his love, but it demonstrated his infinite ability and sympathy to minister to the suffering of humanity. And we see this story as it unfolds. Jesus, his disciples, in the large crowd traveling with them, approaching this small city of Nain that I believe is only mentioned one time in the Bible, and they greet this funeral procession that's coming out of the gate of the city toward the cemetery. And the Bible says that this widow, who must have been a dearly loved woman, a beloved woman, carrying her only son to his burial place, there was another large crowd that was traveling with her. So we have this large crowd who was traveling with Jesus, rejoicing, glorifying God for all that they had been witnessing over the last several days and few weeks and few months. And suddenly there's another crowd that's coming toward them, but it's a completely different sound in that crowd. It's a sound of grief. It's a sound of distraughtness. It's a sound of weeping. It's a sound of almost despair and disarray. Hallelujah. And suddenly Jesus locks in, not on what the crowd that's with him is doing so much, but Jesus locks in on this mother who is grieving, and this mother who is heartbroken, and this mother who is a widow who has lost her only son, and she is so beside herself. Suddenly Jesus, out of all the people with him and with her, he locks in on her and he begins to have compassion over her situation. Come on now. I believe that Jesus is looking at every one of us and he's saying to us, I'm willing to move past whatever I've got to move past in order to get to you. If you'll just be willing to give me your situation today, if you'll be willing to give me your heart, if you'll be willing to give me your dilemma, if you'll be willing to give me your disarray, if you'll be willing to give me what seems to be destruction the enemy's trying to work out in your life, I have the power to overcome this in your life. I feel the presence of Jesus in this room. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So I'm learning something here. Brother Derek, as I've studied this story over the last several months and prayed it for a couple of years, that when I'm in a room full of people like this, it's not always the worshipers and the glory hallelujahs that I need to be focused in on. It's someone who's desperate to touch the hem of Jesus' garment. My eyes are combing this congregation this morning, and I'm not necessarily looking for the person who's already seen the miracle. I'm looking for the person who needs the miracle today. Hallelujah. I'm looking for the person who is in need of the compassion of Jesus touching them and changing their life for the glory of God. Hallelujah. I'm looking for the crowd that's weeping, in the crowd that's hurting, in the crowd that desperately needs a victory in their heart and in their life. Hallelujah. And then everyone else can join in on the new praise that God is doing in someone's life. Can you say amen? Amen. Amen. Clap your hands and praise God. Come on, clap your hands. I feel like we ought to praise him in this place. Hallelujah. Oh, somebody praise him today. Oh, Jesus, hallelujah. Praise his mighty name. So one, Jesus was moved with compassion by the grieving mother. Number two, Jesus had the authority to be present in that situation and to restore life. Look at someone and say, Jesus has the authority. This is what I've learned about Jesus, and you have too, that Jesus has the authority to be wherever he wants to be. He doesn't need my permission. He can be where he wants to be, and he can do what he wants to do, provided there is a willingness for me and for you to allow his compassion in his presence, in his truth, and his power, and his authority to have their sovereign capacity in our lives. If you're here today and you say, I'm willing, say, I'm willing. Amen. Hallelujah. Jesus has that authority. In this passage, Luke the physician uses the word Lord, L-O-R-D, Lord, to describe the person of Jesus. That does not often happen in the gospel accounts of the writer describing. It's usually Jesus or Jesus Christ or Christ Jesus and then on occasion you'll see the word the Lord used. It is very seldom used, however, in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. But in this passage, Luke uses the word. When you research this particular word for Lord in the Greek, it simply means this. It means to be one who has all authority, or the one who is in supreme authority. Hallelujah. And Jesus, in this case, fits the description of both. He is both supreme in authority, and he has all authority in heaven and in earth. If you believe it, shout amen. Amen. A third thing, real quickly, about that also connects to the authority of Jesus. Not only did Jesus have the authority to be present and to restore life when he was moved by compassion for the grieving mother, but number three, Jesus had the authority that allowed him to cross every barrier that stood before him to touch the coffin. And there were some barriers. There are three instances in the New Testament where Jesus restored someone to life. And in each instance, there was a barrier that he had to overcome. In this story, if I could just put them to you in simple terms, number one, there was the barrier of religion. Because everyone who was there that day who was a good Pharisee or a good Sadducee, was it possible to be a good Sadducee? I don't really get that, do you? But everyone who was there that wanted to uphold, quote unquote, not necessarily the law of Moses, but the letter of the law of Moses in the religious perspective of that law, not the life of the spirit version of that law, but a religious interpretation of that law that bound people up rather than freeing people up. The difference in relationship with Jesus in religion is that religion binds you up to a set of laws and circumstances, but relationship with Jesus frees you up to know the living God, hallelujah, and then to fulfill your destiny through the truth of the Word and the power of His Holy Spirit. If you believe it, say yes. And there were particular religious obligations that had to be made by a person who was living if they brushed or come into contact with someone who had died. So in this occasion, when Jesus reached out and he touched the open coffin that the young man was lying in, he instantly had to move past the barrier of religious expectation. In other words, can I come down here for a moment? Can you follow me? Miss Camera Person, if I get too carried away, just wave at me and tell me to calm down and I'll do it, okay? When he reached out and he touched this open coffin, there were people probably both in the crowd that was following him and in the crowd that was following the grieving mother who had an expectation that Jesus was just going to stop everything and doing his religious duty, his religious obligation, and say, I'm unclean, don't touch me, because if you do, you'll be unclean yourself, hallelujah. But Jesus wasn't concerned about all that, was he? Hallelujah. And Jesus is not concerned with what has touched you and tainted you in your life. Can you say amen? Jesus is not concerned where you've been or what you've experienced. He's already died for that. Can you say amen? He's given his life for you to have life and have it more abundantly, hallelujah. He's just desperately concerned, however, that he can bring you the understanding of the life that he has come to give to us as the Son of the living God. Praise God. So Jesus moved past the religious. Oh, praise God. I tell you what, if Mike Gray would have had it dependent on some kind of religious good to come to me and help me find my way, there'd probably never been any hope. Can you say amen? But thanks be to God, Brother Mark, that the Holy Spirit came and showed me Jesus. Can you say amen? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For the Son of Man did not come into the world to condemn the world. Exactly. Why don't we quote verse 17 to this? But that the world through him might be saved. Hallelujah. 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 So this was all that was on Jesus' heart and mind. So he was willing to move past the barrier of religious law regarding the ceremonial defilement, so-called, for touching a corpse. Praise God. I'm so glad for this. Aren't you? Because the Bible says that I was dead in my trespasses and sins. You were dead in your trespasses and sins. If you don't know Jesus today, you're dying in your trespasses and sins, just like I was dying in mine before Jesus came to me. But thank God, Jesus said, Holy Spirit, go touch Karen Harris at that time and tell her that I'm willing to touch that death on the inside of her spirit being and turn it around and make it life. Praise God. Thank God the Holy Spirit went to Fred Stallworth one day. Now, Fred was probably born out of the womb saved. I don't know, but... He's probably about as close as you can come into the world saved. Without really being saved, you know what I mean? But thank God the Holy Spirit came to Fred one day and said, Freddie, village boy, hey, you're dead, but I've got the authority to touch you anyway. Hallelujah. Somebody ought to say, thanks be in the God that though I was dead in my trespasses and I was dead in my sins, the Holy Spirit touched me anyway. Amen. I feel His presence. Praise God. Secondly, there was the barrier of ridicule. Remember when He raised Jairus' daughter back to life? When He got into the room where she was lying, she had died. And Jesus simply said something like this. He said, the girl is not dead. She's only sleeping. And the Bible says that they begin to laugh at Him. They begin to ridicule Him. You want to follow Jesus around? I'm going to tell you something, ladies and gentlemen. Someday you'll try something so out of people's minds for Jesus that, yeah, it'll probably draw a few laughs. Praise God. But that's okay. Can you say amen? You know, somebody might have laughed at me one day several years ago when I witnessed to a young man in the hospital who was weeping and crying and distraught. He had just left ICU and where I had been with another, with a family in my church whose son, six or seven-year-old son who had severe heart disease and issues had just coded while I was in the room with them, and we began to pray in the Holy Ghost. We began to pray and call on the name of Jesus. We began to pray and say, Jesus, bring this boy, his name's Michael, back to life and by the glory of God. And do you know that Jesus restored that boy back to life for the glory of God? Can you say amen? Hallelujah. Jesus restored that boy back to life that day. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I was with him one moment, he coded, he stopped breathing, and then in another moment I was with him and he was talking to me. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody. And then as I left the hospital that day, there was a young man, about 25 years old, who was weeping profusely. And I said, young man, what's wrong? He said, I don't think my loved one, I think it was his father, is going to make it. And I said, oh, let us pray with you. And there was a young minister with me from our church, and I don't think he really understood why I was stopping to pray. People were walking by, and people might have started laughing when they heard me say, Jesus can help you. And that young man looked at me and said, yes, I believe He can. I said, do you know Jesus? He said, no, I don't. I said, would you like for me to pray that Jesus will come into your heart? Because Jesus knows no barriers. You don't have to be in a church. You don't have to be in a chapel. You can come to Jesus right here in this place. Hallelujah. Because Jesus has already moved every barrier there is to come to you. That man got gloriously saved right there that day. And Jesus that day wasn't moved by the ridicule. He wasn't moved by the scorn. He wasn't moved by the laughter at Him, the jesting. He put everybody out. And He went into the room, took the girl by the hand, and spoke to her and said, arise. And guess what? Guess what? Guess what? She rose up. And then there was the time when Jesus went to His good friend's tomb, Lazarus, who had been dead 4 days. Mary and Martha were beside themselves when they saw Jesus come and said, if you had been here, Lazarus wouldn't have died. And Jesus had already said to the disciples, Lazarus is not dead. He's only sleeping. And they said, but Master, he's supposedly been dead 4 days. And Jesus said, we must go. So what was the barrier here? There was a barrier. Jesus was able to move past the barrier of no expectation. None. If you had been here, he wouldn't have died. Everything was in the past tense. Everything was speaking about what was rather than what could be. Hallelujah. Folks, I've come to stir you up today to say, if we by God's grace can begin to talk about what can be for the glory of God in our life, in our family, in our church, in our nation, rather than what is and what's wrong. Oh, I believe we can still see a visitation of the presence of Jesus in this place and in this land for the glory of God. Clap your hands if you believe it. Hallelujah. Jesus simply began to weep because he knew he was about to call Lazarus back from paradise, perhaps. But with a loud voice, he said, roll the stone away. And he called out a command and said, Lazarus, come forth. Now, I just feel like pausing right here for 15 seconds and just saying, Jesus, I don't know what command you need to call out today over every life here. Hallelujah. It's me, I just see you there, and I just begin to pray over you some of the physical things that I know Jesus already has in. He has this. Can you say amen? What command does he need to speak today? Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but I would just give him permission to speak. Can you say amen? And I'm going to shift right here in my close in this point here. I want you to see something maybe that maybe you've never thought about it exactly in this respect. When Jesus put his hand on that open coffin and everyone who was carrying the young man stopped because they must have been arrested by the presence and by the power of God. And Jesus basically said, young man, I say to you, arise. If I could just put it to you like this, and I'm so thankful that I can speak this particular point over this church because I know your heart for the next generation. I know your heart for children, and I know your heart for young people, for students, teenagers, college and career. I believe that Jesus was not only moved with compassion for the mother, feel his presence. But I believe that Jesus was moved with compassion for the next generation. I believe it is time for the church to say to the next generation, arise. Can you say amen, church? Amen. Hallelujah. I feel the presence of Jesus. I believe it is time to release the unbridled faith and the creative purpose that is within the next generation. I mean, there's a number of them here in this room with us today. There's the Derricks, there's the Reeds, there's the John Oglesby's, Sierra. There's the Matt Stallworths that are here in this room with us today and others that we could call by name. I believe it is time for the church to say, we release the unbridled faith and creative purpose that is within you. They have something to share with us. Can you say amen? The young man Jesus restored sat up and he spoke. Hallelujah. I believe that this generation has got something to say to us, and I just want to figuratively call out, lift my voice, and say over the next generation, we release you, we give you liberty, we give you privilege, we give you permission to sit up and speak to us what Jesus is putting in your heart to speak to the body of Christ. Come on now, can you say amen? We must have this next generation. We must have them at their full strength. And the enemy wants to try to bring some kind of workmanship of death over them, but we must stand up in faith and say, no, it cannot be in the name of Jesus. If you believe me, say amen. I believe it's time for us to pray for the Josephs, the Calebs, the Esthers, the Daniels, the Johns. You know, the Apostle John was maybe 18 or 19 years old when he was following Jesus around. the youngest, but one who represented the emerging generation. He was the one who heard Jesus say some things that no one else heard because he writes them in his gospel account in a way that no one else wrote them. Because he heard them in intimate conversation with the Master. I just want to say we're releasing the next generation. Hallelujah. This is how I want to illustrate this and bring this part to a conclusion. On February the 6th of this year, Fox News reported this story. It has been validated. And right before I shared this message in June in South Carolina in a conference-wide camp meeting there, I did some more research on the story. And it's not only validated, the story has gone to another level, to another place that I'll bring you up to speed on in just a moment. This is the story Fox News reported on February 6th of this year. A 14-year-old Missouri boy who was dead for 45 minutes made a miraculous and unexpected recovery. John Smith fell into an icy lake on Martin Luther King Jr. Day. He was trapped underwater for 15 minutes. And a medical team unsuccessfully performed CPR for 30 minutes. Still, young Smith had no pulse. Doctors called Smith's mother to the hospital to say her goodbyes, and she began to pray. That's when doctors say John Smith's heart started up again. Dr. Suderer said the mother started praying loudly. I don't remember what all I said, recalls John's mother, Joyce, but I remember saying, "Holy God, please send your Holy Spirit to save my son. I want my son. Please save him." They had not been getting the pulse at that time, so all of a sudden I heard them saying, "We've got a pulse. We've got a pulse." Within a matter of a minute or two, his heart started again, says Dr. Suderer. It's an experience that shaken many of those in the emergency room that day. This veteran doctor of responding to medical crisis wrote a letter about it as a way to cope. Quote, "His heart was jump-started by the Holy Spirit." His heart was jump-started by the Holy Spirit listening to the request of his praying mother, reads Dr. Suderer from the letter he wrote. Another doctor, Dr. Jeremy Garrett, who oversaw John's recovery, even goes a step further. He said, quote, "It's a bona fide miracle." John was airlifted to Cardinal Glenn and Children's Medical Center about 2 hours after the accident. Dr. Garrett says he knew within the first 16 hours after John's arrival that his body would physically survive the ordeal. What he didn't know was how much brain function he would have. And there's where the end of the story comes. The last research I had, another team had gone to the home. Another team had interviewed the mother again, and this time interviewed John. John's brain capacity was completely recalled and completely recovered by the grace of God. Hallelujah. Because his mother said to the next generation, "You've got to sit up and you've got to speak. Holy Spirit, bring life into my son so that he can represent the next generation." The only issue he deals with is some slight, for lack of a better word, paralysis. He still is a little bit numb, I think, in one of his legs. But other than that, he is completely healed for the glory of God. Hallelujah. You just close your eyes right where you are, right where you're sitting. Holy Father, Thank you for the compassion of your Son that was demonstrated to us through Scripture many, many, many times. And thank you that each of us that are here in this room today are also a witness to the compassionate heartbeat of Jesus, His love for mankind, and His ability, His capacity, His authority to come to us in dire moments and bring about a healing, a miracle, a breakthrough, a belief that something good is yet going to happen in my life. Heavenly Father, there's been such a witness of your presence in this room today. And I feel like just declaring what Jesus declared 2,000 years ago when he stopped that large crowd's movement. And he said, young man, I say to you, arise. Because he had the authority to be there. And he had the compassion to do something about that particular situation. And that young man sat up and he began to speak. And Jesus gave him back to his mother. He restored and made whole and brought newness of life. Holy Spirit, I believe that throughout this room that there are needs. You pressed upon me this morning during our drive that your presence would be in this service and that you would be present to heal and you would be present to make whole and you would be present to say to those in need, I say to you, young man, young woman, older man, older woman, arise in the name of Jesus. I say arise. This is what I'm going to ask you to do. I'm not going to take much time with this. When Jesus touched the coffin, life came back to the boy. Jesus is here to touch you. Jesus is here to redeem you. Jesus is here to move past every barrier. I feel His presence in this room. And I'm going to ask those of you that would just say, Jesus, I need a touch from you today. I'm going to ask you, while no one's looking, everyone's seated, every eye's closed. I'm going to ask those of you that would say, Jesus, I need a touch from you. My body needs a touch. My marriage needs a touch. Some other broken relationship needs a touch. Lord, I need you. In some arena, I'm just going to ask you to stand up where you are and walk down and stand here before this altar. Don't be ashamed, because Jesus stood up and he walked to the cross for you. I'm just asking you to come, whether it be one, whether it be 10, whether it be 20. I'm asking you to come right now. Come and just lift your hands like this to Jesus. Hold your hands as you're comfortable, because Jesus is the healer. Jesus is the one with power. Jesus is one with authority. I need maybe an usher or two to go with me. Hallelujah. I feel His presence. I feel His compassion. Hallelujah. I need Holy Spirit-filled people and people of compassion to stretch your hands toward these who are coming. To stretch your hands this way and begin to pray with me. Thank you, Jesus. I just want you to begin to focus in on that name that is above every other name. Karen, would you just come and help me here? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Holy Spirit, come and fill each one of these and touch them where they are in need. Hallelujah. Pastor John, please, if you would, help me pray. If you feel inclined, you could just come and someone could come and put your hand on the shoulder of one of these and just help us pray here in agreement. Beatrice, I felt a burden from my heart go out for you. Huh, my. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You hear the Lord saying, your weeping has endured for a night. Yea, but joy cometh in the morning. And hear the Holy Spirit say, for me to say to you, stir up the gift of the Holy Spirit which is in you. You're coming out of this dry place as though it were. Glory to God. Even now I feel the breaking. Oh, I feel a breaking of of that place that the enemy has tried to hold you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We bless your name. John, just stay right here with me. I feel the touch of the Holy Spirit coming on this woman of God. Father, we just declare your word. We declare your work. In the name of Jesus, Father, I pray that everything that would try to shackle and bind up this dear sister shall not prosper. It cannot have prospered. It has no authority. Jesus, you have all authority to move past every barrier. Hallelujah. Thank you that there's no barrier that you don't have the ability to move.
Hallelujah. It's hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just lift your hands for a moment in His presence. God has graced us with His presence today in a very tangible way. We know we're always in His presence. And His presence this morning is very tangible. I can tell you that Jesus can move past barriers. You say amen. In early March 2014, my surgeon called me. I was in the Atlanta airport and I was on my way to a meeting. Most of you know a little bit of my story. What I can tell you that day is, he said to me, you have a stage 4. Massive growth. We must operate on you immediately. I said, when did you want me? In Birmingham. He said, you need to come to my office on this day. And I did. I had surgery the next day, which was May the 21st of last year. This is what I learned. This is what I knew, because I've heard my presiding bishop give the devotional that morning, Fred. This is one of the things he said. The point I made about Jesus has authority to move past all the barriers. I began to pray for the first time in my life, and I hope the only time in my life, I almost went to my knees when someone told me something. Thousands of people who walked by me that day, a large crowd. Remember the two references to large crowds in the text? And I cried out to Jesus right then. I said, Lord, what am I going to do? And I was reminded, Jesus, you have the barrier to come past every person who's walking by me right now and to curse this thing and to make me whole in the name of Jesus Christ. And from that day into this day, I can tell you that I have had faith that I would be healed, that I would be whole, that I would fulfill my assignment in life. I will fulfill my God-given purpose for this planet, for a time such as this, for the glory of God. Can you say glory? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My surgeon this past week, and for the first time in 17 months, almost 18 months, he did his endoscope. He pulled it out almost as fast as he pulled it in. He did no bleeding in my sinus passage. He did no retraction in my sinus passage. He did nothing except to say, this looks great. There's a whole lot, except maybe the few times I've preached this message. Because Jesus has the authority to move past the barrier of disease. He has the authority to move past cancer. He has the authority to make you whole in the name of Jesus. He has the authority to bring low blood pressure up and make it moderate. And He has the authority to bring high blood pressure down and make it where it needs to be. He has the authority to remove a cataract. He has the authority.
Thank you.
to do this. I'm sorry. I don't mean to delay. With every head bowed, every eye closed, if you're in this room today, you've not already received prayer for some kind of infirmity in your body. I feel the compassion of Jesus in this room. I just want you to lift one of your hands up and just hold it there for a moment. The one's looking around with me, just hold your hand. Hold it up for the Lord, your God. Hallelujah. Hold it there, we're going to sing that chorus. Especially the part that says, there is no power in hell. There is no one who can stand before the presence of the great I am. Now, Father, you see every hand lifted in this room. You see every situation. You understand every single human being in this room. You understand what's going on in their body. You're the great I am. You're the great physician. You created us. You wired us together. You put us together. Father, and now their maladies, their sicknesses, their diseases that are coming to try to limit those of us, your people. And we just say in the name of Jesus Christ, you have all authority and all power. You are Jehovah Rapha, the Lord our healer. And I proclaim your healing power. I love this people in the name of Jesus. We're going to sing this, and I want you by faith to accept, to receive.
Pastoral expression vote.
Father, we ask that not the heart and the mind of man to be determined here today, but we ask that the heart and the mind of God be determined here today. Thank you for bringing your rich presence to us and for this service that we've experienced that now helps us to do the kingdom business. Thank you, Father, that we will do so prayerfully. And we will do so with our hearts and our consciences open to what each of us may feel is the heartbeat of the Holy Spirit. We say, come kingdom of God, come will of God, and be done. You all know this prayer, I think. Pray it with me, please, as we lead into this part. You can be seated. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Everyone said, amen, and amen, and amen. Praise God. Pastor John Whitaker, thank you guys so much.